Wesker.
So you've come. Chris, you make me proud. But of course you are one of my men.
Thanks. Since when, Wesker?
I'm afraid I don't know what you're talking about.
Since when have they been slipping you a paycheck?
I think you're a bit confused. I've always been with Umbrella. And Stars were Umbrella's... No, rather, my little piggies. The Tyrant virus leaked, polluting this whole place, and unfortunately, I had to give up my lovely members of Stars.
You killed Enrico with your own dirty hands! You son of a bitch!
Enrico? Yes. I'm a fair man. I'll destroy all of you, Stars, along with this entire place.
You.
Time for show and tell. Get up.
Wesker, you've become senile.
Chris, you'll never understand.
It's magnificent.
Come on, you test tube freak!
Albert Wesker was originally meant to stay dead after the first Resident Evil game. But due to his popularity, Capcom decided not to keep him dead and make a shocking reveal that he would make a new appearance in Resident Evil Code Veronica. 2 years after the release of the original Resident Evil 1, a novel was published by author S.D. Perry in October 1st of 1998. In this novel, Wesker meets his demise in a very different conclusion. Let's take a look at his very last moments in the novel known as Resident Evil: The Umbrella Conspiracy. Much like in the original version where Barry hits Wesker in the back of the head with his Colt, Barry slams the butt of his Colt into Wesker's skull as hard as he could, dropping him like a ton of bricks. Jill crouches next to his body and takes his Beretta from Wesker's fingers, disarming him. And after Barry apologizes for following Wesker's treacherous orders, she forgives him and they gaze down at Wesker's sprawled form, still breathing but unconscious. Barry asks if she happened to have any handcuffs on her, but she shook her head and replied, "Maybe we should check out the lab. There's bound to be some cable or cord we can use." But after they stop into the Tyrant room, they get distracted with the reveal of the Tyrant. After analyzing the creature, they feel bad for the person that this creature used to be, and decide to try and put an end to its life. So they look at the console, and see if there's a switch that will terminate the subject. Barry finds 6 red switches in a row and flips them all to see if this will do the trick. But suddenly, the Tyrant begins to pull back its human hand and hit the glass with full force. The glass starts to crack even though it's several inches thick, and Barry quickly grabs Jill's hand and runs out of the room before it's too late. Barry slams his hand down on the door control and it slid open as glass shattered behind them. They stumble through the door, terrified. Barry hits the lock and notices that Wesker is gone. In the original version, if you're playing through Jill's story mode, this is the moment that the self-destruct sequence has been activated, revealing that Wesker escaped and triggered it himself. You don't get to see what happened to Wesker after this, but in the novel, here is what happened next. Wesker stumbled toward the power room, his head pounding. His limbs feeling strangely distant and weak. He felt like he was going to throw up. "God damn, Barry," he says. They'd taken his gun. He'd come to as they'd walk into the lab and reeled toward the elevator. Cursing them both. Cursing Umbrella for creating such a screwed up mess. Cursing himself for not simply killing the Stars when he could have. He says, "It's not over. I'm still in control. This is my game." The sample case was down in the lab, probably being destroyed right now by one of those idiots. Tyrant 2, that magnificent creature, powerless without the adrenaline injections, dead. They'd shoot him in his sleeping heart. He'd die without ever tasting battle. Wesker reached the door to the room that leaned against it. Struggling to catch his breath, blood dribbled out of his ears, and he shook his head, trying to clear it of the strange fog that had settled into his brain. He didn't have the tissue samples, but he could still complete his mission. It was important, very important, that he complete his mission. It was about control, and control was his game. Triggering system. Watch out for monkeys. The MA2s, he had to be careful. Wesker opened the door and pitched forward, the ground seeming too far away and then too close. The machines were hissing at him, whining and hissing in the hot, oily air. His hand found the railing and he pulled himself toward the back of the room, trying to hurry but finding that his legs weren't interested. A claw shot down from above and tore into his scalp, yanking away a clump of hair. He felt warm liquid trickle down the back of his neck and stumbled on. The pain in his head was sharper now. Took my gun. Stupid assholes took my gun. He reached the door and had just managed to get it open when something heavy landed on his back, knocking him into the next room. He fell on the cold metal floor and a terrible shriek sounded in his ear. Thick talons punctured the skin on his back and Wesker slapped at it, at the grinning, screaming thing that was trying to kill him. He hit the creature as hard as he could, shoving the heel of his hand onto his throat. It leaped away, landing on the mesh wall and clambering back up onto the ceiling. Wesker pulled himself up and stumbled on, fresh waves of pain and nausea washing over him. The air was too hot, the turbines loud and relentless in their spinning, throbbing frenzy. But he could see the door to the back now, the door that led to the completion of his mission. All of the stars, dead, blown into orbit while I escape. Fly away a rich man. He flung the door open and made his way toward the small, glowing screen in the back corner. It was quieter here, cooler. The massive machines that filled the chamber hummed softly at him, their purpose quite different than that of the ones outside. These were the machines that wanted to help him regain his control. The noise from the open door behind him seemed far away as he reached the glowing screen, his fingers numb as they touched the keyboard beneath. He found the keys he needed, the code spilling out across the monitor in soft green after only a few minutes. A sexy, quiet voice informed him that the countdown would begin in 30 seconds. Dizzy, he tried to remember the setting for the timer. The system would trigger automatically in 5 minutes, but he had to reset it, give himself time to get reoriented and make his way to the outside. Behind him, something screamed. Wesker whirled around, confused, and saw four of the mesh monkeys running at him, lashing out with long, curved hands as they reached him. Terrible pain shot up through his leg and he fell, crashing to the hard steel floor. "This can't happen," he says. One of the creatures jumped onto his chest and suddenly Wesker couldn't breathe, couldn't even raise his weak arms to push it away. Another tore into his left leg, ripping away a thick chunk of flesh with its hooked claw. The third and fourth screamed in savage glee, dancing around him like dark, vicious children, lifting their claws as they pranced on squat legs. Somehow, there was blood in his eyes, and the world was spinning away, screams and hisses and incredible searing heat blurring his vision, his mind. Tyrant has come. Wesker could feel it, could feel the presence of something vast and powerful touching him. Grinning through the pain, he searched for it through the red haze of his failing vision, wanting more than anything to see it slaughter his attackers in a glory of perfect motion. But he could only make out the immense shadow that seemed to flood over him, through him. Could only imagine that the powerful, magnificent warrior was reaching down to lift him from his torment. "I control. Let me see." Darkness stole his hopes away, and Wesker thought no more. And this ends up being Wesker's final moments. In my opinion, this had to be one of the scariest deaths in the franchise. And if it had to happen to anyone, Wesker was the one who deserved it. It was because of him that most of the Bravo team members faced a torturous death. Wesker mentioned that the Chimera can be avoided in the power room as long as you don't stop running, but being in his condition, that would not be an option, and he could only hope that Jill and Barry managed to kill them all before entering that location. The Chimera are possibly the scariest looking creatures in the Resident Evil franchise, and being hunted down unarmed by a pack of Chimera would be a terrifying situation, and you know that you're about to experience excruciating pain minutes before your life fades away. Wesker deserved every minute of it. That's it for the video. I hope you enjoyed it, and if so, be sure to leave a like, share with others, and subscribe if you haven't. And if you'd like to see some extra content, or you'd like to see your name at the end of the videos, then feel free to support the channel by donating a single dollar to my Patreon. There are also additional perks for donating more than a buck. The link is on the description, along with the link to my Facebook page, Tumblr, DeviantArt, and Twitter. But anyways, I'll see you all in the next video, and remember to have an awesome day.